Sorry, could you say that again? Sorry?
My name is Dominic from the London International Christian Church.
Oh, hi there. Yes. Yes, I've been looking at the church. Thank you very much. I was on the website the other day, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious, do you regard other churches as not saved or other groups as not genuine Christians, or do you accept there are other true Christians in different groups?
We believe there's true Christians.
Right.
But I don't know exactly what you mean by your question.
Well, do you fellowship with other Christian groups?
Of course.
You take part in inter-church meetings with different groups? You pray and you fellowship and you evangelize with different Christians?
What do you mean by different Christians?
Well, Methodists, Anglicans, Baptists, Pentecostals.
If it's biblical, yeah.
Right. What do you mean by if it's biblical? Do you or do you not fellowship with, say, let's just choose groups like, say, the Baptist. Do you regard different Baptist groups as your brothers in Christ?
If it's based on the Bible.
Right. So that's another if. Could you name some sort of meeting recently held in your church or which you've attended in another church where you're fellowshipping with, say, Baptist groups or different groups?
Why do you ask these questions?
Well, I want to know if you regard yourself as the only true Christians in the world or whether you accept that there are different Christians in different groups.
Okay. And why do you want to know that?
Well, because if you regard yourself as the only true Christians, then you'd be a cult like the Jehovah's Witnesses or the Mormons, who regard themselves as the only true Christians on earth, and everyone outside of their little group is unsaved.
Okay.
I've been looking at the teachings of Kip McKean. He started a different group, didn't he? You're the International Christian Church, but he started the, it was the Church of Christ, the Boston version of the Church of Christ, didn't he? The Boston
movement, yeah.
I believe that the two groups have no contact between each other. They don't regard the other group as even being saved, even though they were both founded by Kip McKean. So is it true that the International Christian Church regards Kip McKean's first group, the Church of Christ, founded by Kip McKean, at Crossroads in Florida, that they regard that group as not Christians, or have I got this wrong?
I don't know what you know about the history of the movement, about church history and so on. But if you're open to look at what it biblically means to be saved.
Yeah.
I would love to catch up. Maybe we can do a Bible study together.
Yes. Yes, I'd be quite happy to do that. As long as whatever we agree to discuss, we stick to that one topic. We don't jump all over the shop.
Which one is that? What is that one topic?
Well, one topic that we agree between us, and we stick to that one topic. We don't change 10 minutes into a different topic, and then 10 minutes later we change on to a different topic. So we stick to one agreed topic. Yeah, I'd be quite happy to do that.
Yeah, I think what I like to do is not look at churches per se, but look at what the Bible defines as how to build a relationship with God.
Sorry, I interrupted you, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I like to look at just at the Bible. I don't like to look at different groups, different so-called churches, and so on. So if we're going to meet up, I would love to catch up and just look at what the Bible says about how to build a relation with God. And I think just looking at the foundation, I think that would be amazing.
I'm very curious about baptism. I've heard that you teach that people must be baptized in water by your group to be saved. So you would believe that people who are baptized by, say, a Baptist group or a Pentecostal group, or even the traditional Church of Christ, you regard them as unsaved. Is that correct?
No, we believe what the Bible says, that disciples make disciples.
Right, so if you're a disciple, you don't regard Baptists as disciples, you don't regard the other Church of Christ groups. See, when I was at university in Aberdeen, this was back in the 1990s, I'm getting on a bit, little bit, I'm a little bit old, I'm afraid. I remember seeing a leader from the traditional Church of Christ who was based in Scotland, quite near to Aberdeen, when I was at Aberdeen University.
Mm-hmm.
And he told me that in the 1980s, they had contact from America, from Kit McKean's version of the Church of Christ, that they were going to send out church planters here in Britain, and they were inquiring as to whether they would work with the traditional Church of Christ, who'd been here for over a century. And the man, who was quite an elderly man at the time, was quite shocked that these young people from America said that the traditional church had to work under their authority because they were the only true Christians. And so there was a split, and they wouldn't work together, and therefore the Kit McKean group, when they moved in the 1980s to the UK, I remember there was a group that I attended twice called the London Church of Christ. They met in a huge cinema, which they hired. They regarded all other groups as unsaved, including the traditional Church of Christ. And this traditional Church of Christ man who I spoke to was quite shocked. He said, you know, they're just young and they were quite arrogant, and they regarded themselves as the only true Christians. They regarded everyone else, including us, as unsaved, even though we're Church of Christ ourselves. So, yeah, I'd be happy to look at baptism. Could I just ask, which your international Christian church, which branch? Because you're north, south, east and west, aren't you?
Why is that important?
I just want to know, are you central or north or west or what?
Yeah, and what do you want to know?
All right, I just want to know where you're from, which branch you're from. But if you don't want to tell me, just say I don't want to tell you.
I'm personally from Germany.
Pardon?
I'm personally from Germany.
Well, you speak beautiful English.
Thank you very much. I moved 4 years ago. And so, but I think, it sounds like I love how passionate you are, Robert. I think I hear it in your voice, and just this topic must have been on your heart for a while.
Yes.
And so that's amazing. And I wish there were more, especially in Britain, right, British people who have the same concern. And what I do usually with everybody, that doesn't have to do with if I know them or not. I did the same thing with my parents. and just look at the, as I mentioned earlier, at the foundations of the faith, right? It says in Hebrews chapter 6, it speaks about the fundamental teachings about following God. And one of them is baptism, right?
Yeah, I'm happy to look at baptism. I'm happy to look at baptism.
Like, there's three baptisms mentioned in the New Testament. And yet we also know that in Ephesians that it speaks about that there's only one that's still valid. So baptism is a whole topic and so on, but there's more than that. There's sin and repentance.
I'm willing to do one single topic. What I'm not willing to do is to jump every 10 minutes onto a different topic. So I'm willing to choose one single topic and to look at that. And we go right through it, finito benito, until we've done it, and then we put it to bed and we don't look at it again. Would you be willing to look at baptism?
We can look at baptism, absolutely. Okay. I don't think that this is the first topic that we need to necessarily look at, because the question is really, who is a candidate for baptism? Who can get baptized based on the Bible? So,
another topic I'm interested in would be tithing. Do you practice tithing in the International Christian Church?
Of course, we believe in sacrifice.
No, I asked a question. If you don't want to answer, just say, Robert, I don't answer you. I said, do you practice tithing in the International Christian Church?
Do you mean by you mean by giving 10% of your income?
Yes.
Okay. We totally believe that tithing was in the Old Testament, which was commanded. Nowadays, it speaks about it in 2 Corinthians, where every Christian is called to give generously. My personal conviction is at least 10%.
Right. Okay. Okay. I'm not willing to do multiple topics. I'm willing to look at one thing. I can look at tithing, or I can look at baptism. Which would you prefer to look at?
You've been to university, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Great. Awesome. Me too. I studied computer science in Germany.
Okay.
And then I studied in Australia, in Sydney, and then also here in the UK, in London. So we are from a similar background of just educational foundation. I believe personally that we can look at topics.
Look, I'm not willing to talk about talking. Do you want to look at tithing or do you want to look at baptism? You choose one of those two topics. I'm quite happy to look at that.
I would love to look at what God wants. Like, not like separating and isolating these two topics.
Look, I am not talking, and then 10 minutes later you change the topic, and then 10 minutes later, so we go in a big circle where every 10 minutes you're changing the topic. I prefer to look at one thing and look at one thing in detail. Now, do you want to look at tithing? You see, if you don't know what you're talking about, I don't want to spend the rest of my life talking to you. I want to see whether you know whether you're talking about and whether you're competent. So we could look at tithing, or we could look at baptism, and I know pretty quickly whether you know your Bible and you know whether you're talking about, or whether you're just all mouth. You see, I've spoken to Jehovah's Witnesses, I've spoken to Mormons, I've spoken to Seventh-day Adventists, I've spoken to different people. But it's best to choose one topic and to look at that one topic, because you'll find out pretty quickly whether the person knows what he or she is talking about. Often they don't. Often it's all bluff.
I agree with you.
So let's choose one topic, tithing or baptism. I'm happy to look at one of those two topics.
Okay.
You choose. Which would you like? If you're competent, then I might say I'm willing to talk to you again. But obviously, if you don't know what you're talking about and you're wasting my time, it would be stupid of me to say, well, I'm going to spend the rest of my life talking to you 3 or 4 times a week.
Well, how about you join us on Sunday for church?
If you're willing to pay the hotel bill and the £150 train fare in advance, yes, are you willing to do that? Because I'm about 250 miles away from you.
Okay, fair enough.
I can speak on Zoom. I can speak on Zoom. I can speak on WebEx, and I can speak on the phone.
Okay. Sounds good. I believe...
And I would be willing to attend a meeting, but you have to prove to me beforehand, you know, what it's worth my while. Because obviously, if I speak to someone and they don't know what they're talking about, why do I want to attend their... For instance, I spoke to a Pentecostal the other day. Lord, with Jesus, hallelujah, amen, Jesus. And it was like that for over an hour. He didn't share anything because he didn't know anything. It was just Jesus. Now, if a person doesn't know what he's talking about, why do I need to waste my time involving myself with his Pentecostal church?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I spoke to him, and at the end of the time, I had to say, look, I don't want to talk to you again because you don't know what you're talking about. You're just bluffing me. I asked you a straight question. You don't give me a straight answer. You clearly don't know the Bible. You know, so we could choose a topic, we can talk about it. If you know what you're talking about and you interest me, that you actually do know what you're talking about, you have something of value to share with me, then I would be pretty daft not to speak to you again. But if all you can do is just play word games with me and tricks with me, where you talk about talking about talking about talking and talk about having a study and talk about having a study, then... No, if you never get to the Bible, you're just talking about it. Then it's probably not going to be a waste. It'll probably be a waste of my time.
Okay, fair enough. What we can do is, I believe personally in teacher and student relationships.
Yes, again, you're talking about talking. Do you want to discuss tithing, or do you want to discuss baptism?
Can I share something? I feel very disrespected by you.
Well, I'm probably more than twice your age. I'm in my 60s. Please, yeah, just get to the point, man. Because you don't get to the point.
I do if you. I allow you to speak. Correct. Is that correct?
Just get to the point, man. I'm not interested. Get to the point. Because I feel you're playing games with me. I feel you're not being straight and honest with me.
Okay. So I believe in teacher and student relationship. Either you teach me what you believe about tithing or baptism, and I can respond to what I believe. Maybe you have something to teach me.
All right.
But I'm not gonna sit here, teach you certain things with you having an agenda in the back of your mind. We go, no. So I believe that either you teach me and I can respond, or I teach you. Either
okay,
one, but
you teach me on tithing. How about that? Let's choose tithing. And when do you want to speak? When is it convenient to speak?
Well, let me finish my thought. If we have the role that you are the teacher, you can teach me about tithing. You can teach me about baptism. If it's a role for me to be teaching you, then I will choose a topic which will lead to the topics that you mentioned. And I believe in topical studies. We not switch from one topic to another every 10 minutes. I believe in that. But we got to make sure that either you are the teacher or I'm the teacher. And then we got to allow the teacher to have the freedom to teach what they believe leads up to what we actually want to end up in. So that is the ground foundation, I believe, for our meeting. If we're meeting up, I'm happy to meet up on Zoom and you teach me about your tithing, or you allow me to teach and I teach you what I believe and what we believe and what the Bible teaches.
I'd like to hear what you have to say on tithing.
Okay, then we'll have to do about 6 Bible studies until we get to tithing.
No. You share with me what you've got to share on tithing. I'm not, my time is limited. Please, I'm busy. I'm a busy man. Get to the point. I'd like to see what you teach on tithing. You find somebody else who's got 6 Bible studies. I don't have the time, because if you don't know what you're talking about, I don't want to waste 8 to 10 hours to find out that you don't know what you're talking about on tithing. I'd prefer to actually find out, what does your church teach on tithing? I'm interested in that, and I'm interested in your church's view on baptism. I'm really interested in those two. I'm willing to meet on Zoom. I can meet much later today, or Saturday, or Sunday. I can never speak on a Monday, and there's always next week. What sort of thing would be convenient? What time?
Okay, you're not available on Monday. I'm busy, so Sunday, there's no free time. We can meet on a Tuesday afternoon, Tuesday evening, what would be. But if we speak about tithing, you will have to teach.
All right.
I will not teach you about tithing.
All right.
Right away.
Tithing, okay. Right, okay, tithing then. What time on Tuesday? If you choose a time in the afternoon, I've got appointments, but I can shuffle them around if I know way in advance what time it is.
Okay, we can meet on Tuesday at, let's say, 6 p.m.
6 p.m. Could you send me the Zoom details, please? Because I've never set up a Zoom room, but I do know how to attend a Zoom room. Would you send me the code?
I can send you a Zoom link.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you very much indeed. I forgot your name. I'll write it in my diary. It's
Dom, D-O-M.
D-O-M, and I'm Robert. Thank you, Dom. All right, I'll do some preparatory. I'll go over my scriptures again, and I'll look at tithing. And I'll look forward to see you next Tuesday then at 6. Thank you.
Wonderful. See you next Tuesday.
Okay.
Bye, Robert.
Bye-bye, Dom.